Tonight to go back to St. Mark's Gospel, which we left at the beginning of Advent. But I'd really like to just read a good comment, a garden passage where we just got to in Mark's Gospel. But to really bridge over from the Christmas story that we've been considering into Mark. I think very much that as we look at the reality of what Jesus did at Christmas, although the Christmas story gives us an accurate account of it, it also gives us a very vivid and to some extent stylized account of it. When you get to St. Mark's Gospel, as we've known, as we've been looking at it, it is very common to garden. I think it is good that we should bridge over from Christmas into the new year, from the slightly extraordinary into the much more mundane. And this passage perhaps will help us with that. It's Mark 3:7, which is just after where we got to at the beginning of Advent. And Jesus went away to the lakeside with his disciples. Great numbers from Galilee, Judea, and Jerusalem, Idumea, and Transjordan, and the neighborhood of Tyre and Sidon heard what he was doing and came to see him. So he told his disciples to have a boat ready for him to save him from being crushed by the crowd. For he cured so many that sick people of all kinds came crowding in upon him to touch him. And the unclean spirits too, when they saw him, would fall at his feet and cry aloud, "You are the Son of God." But he insisted that they should not make him known. You're all very familiar, we've been on about it for a great, for weeks and weeks and weeks, that the good news of Christmas was and is Emmanuel, God is with us. And a number of times I've referred and spoken to, spoken about the manger and that God is at ground level and that he has come and he comes to poor people and ordinary people and weak people and all that sort of thing. The whole stable, Frank, I got more than one of me. All right. Flatten it off, can you, a bit? That's great. That the number of times that I've spoken about with crib scenes and all this sort of thing, about Jesus comes in the stable and in the manger, isn't that amazing? And it is amazing that he comes to ordinary people like you and me, that God does not remain aloof. I've said in several big services, the good news of Jesus is God is with us, God is landed, God is at ground level. And that is absolutely true. But it's also quite stylized in the sense of we have the whole manger, stable, shepherds, angels, wise men scenario around it. And when you take your Christmas tree down, you realize that that scenario is not where everybody lives. And certainly it's not where the disciples lived. But the fact remains that that truth, that Jesus is with us here, is the foundation for our new year. That Jesus has come and Jesus remains. There's a little story in Luke, actually, isn't it, of where Jesus, having sort of as a baby being presented in the temple, this is one story of where he's a young man or an adolescent, and they all go up to the temple. He goes with the family and an extended family and half the tribe. And you start to think, Jesus being at ground level is not a passive and a straightforward thing. I sometimes think when I'm saying, Jesus come, Emmanuel, God with us, it's a bit like meeting God in the middle of a big car park. What's good is we're both standing on the ground. What's good is that God is not up there, but down here. But in fact, what's lovely is that he's down here, but actually it's more complicated than that. Because when you begin to see Jesus in the everyday, with his parents, with his extended family, with all the hangers-on, and in all the noise and bustle and colour of going up to Jerusalem for the festival, and then staying too long and having a bit of a difficult conversation with his mother and all that sort of thing, you think, yes, as soon as God is with us, that is not straightforward. It's complex, because life is complex, and things happen, and there are donkeys, and there are roads, and there are houses, and there are situations, and people think this, and people think that. it's not so much just that he is here in some sort of horizontal sense of God has come down, but as soon as he gets down, there's a lot down here to get mixed up with. It's almost of a sort of more of an interlinkage, more of an interdigitation of all this stuff that's going on in his life. And when you get to this lovely passage from Mark I just read to you, it's a good comment, a garden passage. It's the early part of his ministry. Jesus does not have huge opposition. This is not just pre-Easter. It's not dramatic in that sense. We read that, and he went away down onto the lakeside. He's in Galilee, which is at home. He goes down to Galilee, which is his lake. He's with his friends. They got a boat. And other people come along because they've heard what he's been doing and they are enthusiastic and pressing upon him. And I always feel at this time of the gospel, the sun is still shining. It's good news and everybody thinks it's good news and that's good. But it's hugely sort of Jesus down to earth-ish. Much more, I think, than sometimes than just the manger. They live by the seaside. They don't live in the stable. The first disciples are fishermen, not shepherds. They come out into the broader world. And Jesus goes down, sits down with them, talks. He's near the side, keep the boat there, he says. Wonderful passage of normality. And I would encourage you, as you look at this coming week, to think, I'm not in the stable, and visually, I'm not surrounded by angels. And I can't pretend to be a shepherd. I'm going to do an ordinary week. But the message of all these passages, that Jesus is not just at ground level, but Jesus is interdigitated, Jesus is interlocked with all the aspects of your life, personal, corporate, family, professional, sophisticated or not. I just have to think that myself. I think it's obvious, but it's not easy. From my point of view, you know, if I'm supposed to be preparing some services or some sermons, I might think, definitely something to pray about. It's definitely there's something like Jesus is involved with. You might feel in your prayers or your devotional times, this is definitely a time when Jesus is near, definitely a time to pray. But there are other times. Jesus was not always in the synagogue, was he? There are other times. I'm thinking on New Year's Day when we visited our eldest daughter and their house was full of people and grandchildren and noisy presents. Wisely, they had given my eldest grandson a drum kit. Thank you, Lord, Prince of Peace. Anyway, he's got the idea that to play drums properly, you've got to hit them loudly. So, and I'm thinking, that's where Jesus is. Right there. It's a lovely feeling. Jesus is sitting there by the drums going, go on, hit it louder. You feel that, you know. And yet another time, just on Christmas, my wife was doing a bit of a recipe of something or other, and she got her old recipe book open with all these loose leaves, and there was a recipe there that she inherited from my mother, written in my mother's handwriting. And it just gets to you sometimes. You see somebody's handwriting who's died a long time ago, and then you think, And then Jesus is looking over your shoulder, and Jesus is saying, oh, yeah, it's really sad, isn't it? So he's there as well, you know? Or when, as I hear, want to garner lots of sympathy, where running along the prom at dusk last week, I just scuffed into one of those wonderful paving stones left by our glorious council and fell over and scrunched all my hand and all my face and all my legs, and there was blood all over the place. And do you feel well? Jesus says, well, let's get up, shall we, and carry on. Or as the guy in the book, An Ordinary Day with Jesus, says, Can I feel that in cleaning my teeth, Jesus is there with me? By the lakeside. Not in a formalized stable and a manger where I am not. But the truth of that is for the everyday. And as you look forward into this week and this year, you think, in every aspect, in every nook and cranny, Jesus is there, looking over your shoulder, sympathizing, putting you right, rejoicing, being the most extraordinary places, sitting down with us this morning. But I also thought this. If you go back to the Christmas story, it is so special that this baby is in the manger because the baby is so special. Unless the baby is special, it's really not very special that he's in the manger. That might seem a truism, but it's easy to miss that at Christmas because in the story we are aware of his specialness. We are aware of the supernatural aspect of this because we have the angel choir and the moving star. It is to us a given that this is the Son of God, and so it's amazing that he's in the stable and he's at ground level. But if you lost sight of that, it wouldn't be particularly, it might have a bit of an awe factor because people like babies, but that's not going to work, is it? None of the shepherds turned up on the night because they like babies. And they might like babies, but they got other things to do. Neither do they turn up because it's so extraordinary that a baby is born in a manger. I mean, in those days of hard times, the poor had their children all over the place, in caves and in barns and under bushes and in the open air. I mean, it's an unusual place for the Son of God to be born, but it's not a particularly unusual place for a child of a poor and poor family in transit, as you say. Now they come because of the angels, because of the supernatural aspect of it. We better go and see this baby. Not, hey, we better go and see a baby. And the wise men, they're not wandering across the whole of the Middle East looking for a baby. They're actually following a star because it's a king that is born, not just an old baby. When you get to the story of Jesus going up to the temple with his parents, what have we got that story for? Because they like us to know that he was normal and he went around and did things and went to the temple. No, we've got it there because at that one point, Jesus says to his mother, I must be in my Father's house. And there at that point, shining through all the normality, all the humanity, all the being amongst us, being one of us, he is also the Son of God, and that breaks through. That's what makes it special. And when we come to this great passage in Mark, why have they all come? Have they all come because Jesus was a nice guy and sat around and discussed the price of fish with them? No, they're not. They're there because we read they heard about what he had been doing. And what he'd been doing, he'd been spectacularly healing hundreds of people of their illnesses and casting out demons. That is not normal. He is one of them. But he's not one of them. And this lovely passage, let's go down by the seashore and hang on to the boat, and this, and this, and this, is actually a complete break-in of the supernatural of the Son of God. That's why it's amazing to say, oh, it's Jesus was here by the seashore with people, normal people like you and me, and will be into 2015. It's only extraordinary because he's extraordinary. It's only a passage that's worth reading because this is the Son of God. This is a divine thing. This is, otherwise, all I've got is setting. I think this is huge, hugely important. Our Queen did her bit again with her Christmas message and gave testimony to Jesus. Brilliant. But with a monarchy like our Queen, a monarch like our Queen, sometimes you will get, and the Queen went and visited so-and-so, and the Queen went there, and the Queen went there. And there's almost a sense sometimes which we like our Queen to know that our Queen is human like the rest of us, and is one of us. But that only works so long she stays special. It really doesn't work if the Queen becomes so domesticated that she's not the Queen anymore. There was a problem that with their PR back in the sort of 80s and 90s, but I think we've got over that now. Because if you get to sort of one of these Scandinavian monarchs, when they all say, oh, they're so wonderful, they're just like everybody else, they just ride around on bicycles in the capital. Who wants a monarch who rides around on a bicycle? I can ride around on a bicycle. When you lose the specialness, the fact that they are a bit like you loses its specialness. That's the point. That Jesus is one of us. And that's amazing because he's not one of us. He is amongst us, and that's amazing because he is the Son of God. He's sitting there on the seashore, and that's amazing because he's just healed hundreds of people, revealing the coming of the kingdom of God, not talking about the price of fish. And that when Jesus comes to us in this new year, what is amazing that he is amongst us. He is there at the cleaning of my teeth, and yet he is the Son of God. If I lose that, I lose the specialness. And I think we're often in danger of doing that. For over 1,000 years, the church found it really difficult to come to terms with Jesus on the ground, Jesus really human. Because of their devotion to Jesus, Jesus just couldn't be normal. And so all the art you will see, Jesus has always got a glow around him in ancient Christian art. He always hovers slightly off the ground, or has a halo, or is surrounded by angels. The message is he came to earth, but not quite. And for devotional reasons, you can see why that was. In the last century, though, in the 20th century, there was a concerted effort to change that and to emphasize the humanity of Christ. And that was good, so long as you hung on to the divinity of Christ, which in the second half of the 20th century, they did not. And so it was always Jesus amongst us, the friend of sinners, the man for the lost, the man amongst the refugees, the man of this and the man of that. And again and again and again, we came into the fact that God is with us. That's what's so good. He's with us. And we have lost the sense of who he is, and that's his specialness. So Christianity has become relevant, but not revolutionary. It talks about the right things, but there's none of the supernatural in it. It's almost as though we are called upon to be people who make friends with fishermen and talk about the price of fish. Anybody can do that. We're called upon to be nice people and to follow the friend of the sinner, the friend of the poor, the friend of the all. That's good, but it's only good if you're not normal. It's only good if you're special. It's only good if something special happens. And it's easy for us to go into this new year because we are Christians, just with a sense of God's presence rather than God's absence. And that's a huge comfort. But God's presence is not all there is to it. Jesus was present, but they didn't come because he was present. They came because he'd been healing people. They came because he was the supernatural, divine Son of God who was at ground level. There was a couple of times just before Christmas where we had some jolly school carol services, and this place was packed, great vision of how it could be one day. And there were people all over the gallery, and I get my 5 minutes or 3 minutes or 30 seconds just to say something at the end of these services, you know, and that's good. And what do I say? I'm not sure what I'm going to say. But what I did say was, good news at Christmas, God is with us. And I thought afterwards, that doesn't really work. Not because it's not true and not because they're really nice people. But because if you're not really convinced about God, what does his being with us mean? What does it mean, you see? It's only amazingly good news because God is God. It's only special because he's special. You lose that specialness and you've just got a vague sense of presence. So good that God has come amongst us. But somehow he's become secularized and loses the supernatural spark. So in all those things, I need to sense the powerful presence of God being God, rather than just being here. We do not want to be a church just where God is here. We need to be a church where God is God. And that balance is huge. The balance is not lost. We find in these passages that we are not overwhelmed by the supernatural, which and the normal seems to be, you know, just there for the details. You see in the story, the Christmas story again, yes, we've got the balance between Jesus in the manger and the angels. We can hold that. But after it, when the business of going into Egypt, Jesus is never vulnerable. Jesus is never under threat. When Herod decides he might threaten him, an angel has him removed into Egypt until, pithily, the Bible says, and after Herod was dead, then the angel said, as Jesus says later in his life, "No one takes my life away from me, I give it up." There's no security problem in the cosmic sense of things. The Son of God is totally secure from Herod. And yet, he still does the manger thing. He still could have been dropped by Mary, or he could have still been trodden on by the donkey. It's that balance. And when we go to, this is what really caught my eye in this story of Matthew, is when he says to his disciples, "Do you think you could just keep the boat there in case these people push forward and crush me?" An extraordinary thing to say. When we know quite well he could have walked off across the water. When this one who's just been healing all these people, which means biology, biochemistry, and at the end of the day, atomic physics, still decides that he will do the boat thing if necessary. He will still be human. He'll still be there. Let's do boats and water and wood. Although we could do anything. The balance is there. And in that little story that I said in the bridge between the two, when he goes up to the temple and then his mother says, "Son," and you feel for her very much, "where have you been? We've been looking for you, you've had to come back, and you've hurt us, and I've been anxious," and oh, this sort of thing. It's not just that he says, "Mother, you're dealing with God here." What he says is, "This is my Father's house. My Father, I live here. This is my Father's house in the temple. And with precedence, I do what my Father says rather than what my mother says." And that is crucial. And after that, he goes home with her. After that, he goes home with her. There is the balance. And I would just encourage you with this thought, whether it is in my work or my cleaning my teeth or my sorting out the fridge or doing the garden or dealing with my kids or my parents or my whatever it is, whether it's being devotional or whether it's doing DIY, whether it's good, bad or indifferent, Jesus will be there with you this week. But he's not just there as a presence. It's nice that he's there, much better than if he wasn't there. He is there as the divine presence. They pressed in upon him because they heard what he had done. And in my life and in your life, it is great he is here because he is great. Not just because he's here. And to sense that supernatural spark in every conversation, in every aspect of your life, that says, this is different because he is here and because he is who he is. Emmanuel, God is God and God is with us. The band are just going to come and reassemble themselves. And in our commitment for our new year, we do so commit ourselves with the Lord in the sense that he is the Lord, not just he is the one who is here. Okay? So we're going to sing "All Hail the Lamb Enthroned on High." In other words, we're doing the vertical bit, not just the horizontal bit. We retain the vertical even when we've taken down the Christmas tree. Yeah? Let's stand together and